So, hello and welcome everyone to yet another School Synergy session. I am Ruchi Kumar, Assistant Professor at Tata Institute of Social Sciences at Center for Excellence in Teacher Education. So, today's session is actually a continuation of the last session that we had using science stories to teach science, in which Poonam Medh shared her idea of how stories about science can be used in the science classrooms to develop an understanding of nature of science itself. So in this session, we thought that we will discuss a few ideas coming from you all, because this is essentially a school synergy platform that we have tried to build up, in which we want people to share ideas from both sides. So one from university researchers or teacher educators, they can share their ideas, they can share their work. And we also want teachers to be able to share their work and their ideas. And till now, we have been having sessions where people have listened to these seminars. They have interacted on chat and responded by unmuting. And we have been very happy with the kind of interaction that we have got in the sessions itself. But we want to take it beyond. So therefore, we created this Telegram group in which we can have these discussions after the sessions itself, and we have been managed to do that. But now we want even more. We want these sessions, teachers should start sharing their own ideas, sharing their own experience of innovation, of using ideas belonging to the same theme itself. So today's session is the first of its kind. And we were hoping that a few of you will at least post your ideas on the Telegram group so that we can take it up here in the session itself. There have been a very few ideas which were shared on the Telegram group. So what we will do is we will, in this session itself, ask you to think about it creatively and think with us together, perhaps, and share ideas which can be perhaps later on taken to your classrooms and tried out with your own students. And perhaps if you can post on the Telegram group your experiences, and if we feel that substantial people are interested in discussing their experiences, we can have yet another session about it. So let us start this session by just asking the people who have joined. You can respond on chat if you want to share an idea in this session today. If you're interested in sharing an idea today, if you've already thought of an idea or not, even if you have not thought of an idea, it's okay. Let's see if you come up with some ideas while we are discussing in the sessions itself. So may I have some responses on the chat if you have been able to think of some ideas based on the session done last week? Any responses? Anybody wants to unmute? Yeah, I know it is quite challenging to be able to share one idea in front of a public group. But I think it is something which is necessary for all of us to do, to enable us to support the innovation that we are trying to do, to open ourselves to feedback, and to open our ideas to getting comments from others in terms of like how we can improve it further. So it would be really nice if you can all can participate in this session in this way. You can share your ideas. Okay, Aruna Prabhu, would you like to share? Go ahead, please.
Hello. Yeah, this is Aruna. And I had shared an idea on the Telegram group.
Yeah.
So I will just be repeating that.
It's okay. Just go ahead.
Yeah. So I am a speech therapist and I worked in a school as a counselor, and taking life skill classes was part of the responsibilities that I had to do. And in 10th standard, we were discussing about career choices to be made. And, you know, in 10th standard, students have a vague idea of what they are interested in. And they have a good idea about what they want from a job or a career when they actually go out into the real world. So we were talking about how it is all right to not have very concrete plans, because, you know, life can throw up so many opportunities, and we have to be flexible about how we deal with those opportunities in terms of job or career. So we discussed two stories, career stories. One is the career story of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. So, and the other is the story of Dr. Manmohan Singh. So through their lives, they have done so many different things which were not necessarily connected to each other. So it was good, because the children realized that, you know, being flexible and being open to opportunities is a great way to be. And it is all right to not have very concrete plans in 10th standard. So I had the opportunity to share the same stories in a CBSE teachers meet also. And it was fun, because all the adults around also started thinking about how their own careers had never been what they had planned in 10th standard. So it was good.
Thank you for sharing that idea, Aruna.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah. It just helps students to actually revisit some of the people who have been in limelight, and to see that their careers were not as structured, and that it's all right to kind of do U-turns. And that is pretty much one of the things that we try to do through bringing stories of scientific discovery, where sometimes it is portrayed as being a straight line. I hope I'm audible and I hope I'm clear. It is portrayed as being a straight line with no missteps and no U-turns. And that's one of the characteristics of science as well. Or for that matter, in many fields. So we have one more raised hand from Roshna Joseph. Yes, please go ahead.
Hello, I'm Roshna, basically from Bangalore. I'm a science teacher. I teach chemistry and physics in high school.
Okay.
So I was always interested to read stories. So definitely, I guess children also will be interested. So I was looking for a story to teach Archimedes' principle of buoyancy. So we all know the story of how Archimedes, while taking bath, and all this Eureka story where he ran in the streets and things like that.
Yeah.
But when I was going through YouTube, I actually found another wonderful link which said real story of Archimedes, where it sort of explains what was the background of why he, the incident in the bathtub was just the aha moment. But there is a lot of backstory where he wanted to design a huge ship.
Yes.
And all those things are coming to that. So I think that made a lot of sense to children and a lot of helped them to understand the history behind the last aha moment. So I just wanted to share that.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's a very good point, actually. As we said in the last session, the Eurekaization of these stories, only revealing the aha moment, makes students believe that, you know, science is a flash in a pan. It's a chance thing, which it is not. So it's good that you were able to expand on that story, which is now very popular in textbooks as well as in popular media. Thank you for that. Just to kind of further this discussion, Roshna, I'm going to display the tenets of NOS on the screen. Which tenet do you think the Archimedes story that you just mentioned, which tenet do you think it maps to?
I think it helped the children understand the social and the cultural context.
Yes.
Plus, there was an element of the empirical. We always say science is empirical.
Yes.
And so I think those two are the ones where I connected to them.
Absolutely. And my feeling is that the more you delve into that particular part of history, the more you tease it out, some of the things that will reveal to you may map to more of these tenets, which are all equally important for students to appreciate as they go along learning science. Thank you once again.
Anybody else?
Yeah, anybody else who would like to?
You can try sharing your idea. Yeah. Go ahead, Poonam.
Yes. Thank you, Ruchi. So what we'll do here is let's try and collectively ideate here today and understand that while there is a fair amount of research, etc., required, but once you have the intent to say that, yes, these are important tenets and they have to be included in the science syllabus, how do you actually arrive at these? So I'm going to open one slide. Yeah. So here is a screenshot actually of the NCERT textbook on science. This is chapter 3, and as you can see that it begins with a little bit of history of the atoms. So how would you think you could introduce nature of science in a chapter like this? Any views, any ideas? I can display the entire chapter and on the screen if required. Not entire, but we can do the whole page if that helps.
We request you to participate more actively in this session, because this is an ideation session and we are trying to help you think of ideas that you can use in the classroom. So you have to participate. It would be really nice.
Noon, one and all. I just would like to know, I just now joined only. May I know the previous instruction you have shared with all of us?
In the previous session, basically, we said that, history of a scientific discovery is an important curricular need, which can also help increase storytelling in the classroom, specifically science classroom, and it can teach the sociocultural aspects of science. So that was, and I had shared two stories as an example of how stories can be brought into the science exam classroom. So that is what we did in the first session. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
How would you go about now? As you can see on the screen, there is already a hook, if you can say, kind of a starting point that you have about how ancient Greek and Indian philosophers thought about matter. And as you can see that there is a mention of a Kanad who said that if we go on dividing matter, it becomes smaller and smaller particles. Now you have this particular starting point in the chapter. What do you, if you had to incorporate a story of scientific discovery, how would you convert this into an opportunity to bring in a story? As you can see, this is itself not enough to convey all the aspects of nature of science. So what in addition to this, you know, how would you kind of bring this in front of the students? And I don't want answers, I just want some ideas. What would be your approach? What would you look for? How would you go about it?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, hello. Hi.
Ma'am Smriti here. So I was just thinking if you can start with asking them about what do they know about the matter. Mm-hmm. And they must be having some kinds of ideas or how what will happen, is there anything inside the matter again. Mm-hmm. So once we hear some of the answers from the students, then we can tell the stories, obviously not these tidbits of stories, but one or two complete stories that we know. Mm-hmm. And then we can tell so that they will be able to link like what the way they think, even this the process the scientists went through, the uh-huh. process is same, and in that way then after that we can introduce the concepts maybe.
All right, okay. Yeah, that's a good point, that by asking them about what they think of and taking that as a starting point. But that still doesn't add up to a story. So how would you, try to bring in nature of science I'm going to show you the next page. See, now there is that same paragraph continues. So it starts from Kanad, then it goes into philosophers like Democritus, and then it jumps to the 18th century here. Yes, Aruna, please share your thoughts.
So if you see the words that they have used, they begin with philosophers and then they proceed to scientists.
Excellent observation.
So maybe we can think about how first we should raise the right questions. And then think about methodologies to arrive at answers for those questions.
Absolutely.
So maybe things like thought experiments and all that will come into the picture.
Yes, yes. Absolutely. That's an
excellent idea.
Yes.
Absolutely excellent. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So it also, see, because of that observation, it opens up the thought. And if you could point this observation to students, because this is 8th standard, and you can urge them to think that why is it that there is a mention of philosophers, and it opens up a whole area of inquiry to say that, and it drives, you're starting to drive around the point that science was all about asking questions, and later on it of course it merged as a different discipline, but it's a very good way to get students to think about it and ask some questions themselves, that why are we referring to philosophers here, what has science got to do with that, and then it opens up discussion. Anyone else would like to share? So I would like to ask you, instead of an idea, I would just possibly like you to, when you went away from the session Yes, so we have someone who, Prachi. Yes, Prachi, please share your thoughts.
Hi, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, actually, what we do as teachers, educators in our classroom, I'd just like to share that one example with you all.
Sure.
Basically, I've used this quite often. We use some energizers before we begin the session. Mm-hmm. So for example, if we have to talk about atoms or molecules in a particular session, what I'll do, I'll carry a jar with me with a few balls, different colors and different size balls, and would ask students before explaining any content or before even introducing the chapter, I'll ask them, what do you think of this? And maybe try to compare it with different answers and different responses from the students, and then get to explaining the concept to them. So that has really worked for me and can form the foundation of the story.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Very interesting. That's a very good...
Hello. Can I share?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Ukin Pam. I'm working in Samsi College of Education. And usually I teach physics and then train the teachers how to teach. So far the science stories is a very good initiative because some children, they love to listen the stories. And I think that you have done a wonderful, you want to have the background. So if people know the background, then it's easier to follow. In our college, whenever we introduce a topic, there should be a like flow chart, like last time you are showing a map, how the history started on that particular topic. Yeah. So the student do that exercise. Whether they implement in the school, that we have no idea, because we are in the big, like training institute, and the students, our trainees, they go and teach in the school. Yeah. And then in the stories, like what I like about is that the background, if you are trying to make a book, then background, the teacher can do it. Then you give an option for the students, yeah. The students or the teachers or the learners, because based on the background, they can have a dramatization,
yeah.
Or they, yes, can do a role play.
Yes.
Or they can write a story or the, yes, cartoons. So I think these are the options which children may enjoy, because different children learn in a different way. No way is a good way. All are good ways to educate the students. So this is what I felt, and I enjoyed meeting everybody. Over here, we are 39 of us floating in the same boat, trying to bring the standard of the science education in our own country. So thank you so much. This is what I want to share.
Thank you so much. It was really interesting to hear your ideas, and you gave very interesting ideas. Role play, definitely. The background of the story, all these things are very, very important things. And these are the activity structures. So I was also thinking about that. See, there are two parts to this. One is selecting which story you want to do and what concepts and ideas that you want to discuss with the students. So it may be the understanding of the concept itself. For example, when you're talking about Archimedes, the concepts of volume and other concepts can perhaps be explored. Then the density concept can be explored. So you need to think about what are the different concepts that can be explored. You need to think about what kind of nature of science ideas that perhaps students can come up with after listening to the story. And then there is a second part. The second part is, what kind of activity will you do around the story? So whether you will just narrate the story and then ask questions, or whether you will ask students to do role play, or whether you will ask students themselves to write their own story from their own perspective. So all these things is something that we wanted you all to think about, like think how you can use this idea in your own classroom. Thanks a lot, Dr. Ugyenpe, for sharing your ideas. Anybody else is also welcome to share during the session whenever you come, whenever that bulb pops up.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes. Go ahead.
Yes, Aparna.
Yes, ma'am. For explaining this chapter, this is very typical chapter you have to explain to the child, because first of all, you have to provoke the imagination power of the child, because you can't, practically you can't show them particle, this atom and molecule, especially atoms. So first, I think, because before that, they have started in class 6 with electricity. And electricity is an older concept in comparison to the
this
atom. So we can connect with the key, that key kite experiment. Mm-hmm. Then we will come, because before this chapter, they have already studied about the compound formation. Even coming to this chapter, they have also studied about the valencies of the molecules. So already, because in 6th, 7th, and 8th, we have discussed about the valencies of few elements. So first, bring the concept of electricity. Then, correlate this topic with how, when we have studied already about the terminology cell in biology, about the constitution units of living organisms especially. So we can connect that when living organisms are made up of cell, then how these non-living on all the materials in this world is made up of which constitution, or which is a unit of constitution of all of us, even living and non-living. Everyone carries atom in their structure. And then we will come to the concept of their discovery, or their history of discovery. Because most of the time, generally, first of all, philosophers give some concept, then scientists work on it. Like in astronomy, generally first the philosopher were there, then the scientific research were done on this concept of astronomy. So we can interconnect it, all the subjects. With cell as well as with key kite experiment and this electricity conduction, then we will come to the atom and the discovery of atom.
Excellent ideas and excellent thought of connecting prior knowledge from lower standards and making that whole stringing it along as so to bring conceptual clarity and to bring in conceptual interconnectedness of all the things that have been done through each class. Thank you so much for sharing this.
Welcome, ma'am.
Yes, Aruna.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes. Have something to share.
Ma'am, I also would like to share a small idea which I thought, if it will be as a story, like stories are always fascinating children and even elders also. So I feel that as they are comparing the Greek philosophers and the Indian philosophers, so with the help of the pictures of all the great scientists of the Greek times and Indian times, just bringing a comparison and how they parallelly worked together on towards these discoveries, and finally they came to a common conclusion, as in the in genetics, as we are bringing them like several branches, our old ancestors are like, they are finally concluding to the common conclusion that yes, we all have originated from the same ancestors.
See.
The same ways Greek philosophers, one timeline, and compared with the Indian one's contribution. So this is the way the children will be able to know all the scientists who have not been that much known to the children.
Yes.
And for the very first time, they would come to know about the various scientists who have contributed in the Greek timings also, and as well as our Indian contribution. So that parallel comparison will also be there, and the thought process will also be understood ki how, you know, in whenever it comes in the terms of research and discoveries, brain works in the same manner, whether it is of Greek ancestry or it is of Indian ancestry, and we can come to the common conclusion finally that yes, atoms are every matter is made up of particles like that.
Yes,
that is really an interesting idea of comparing the timelines itself, and would be really interesting for students. You can also think about in what way the context, the historical context, has supported the scientist or philosopher of their time to think about a certain idea. So I think that is also a very important thing, because usually when we teach science, it seems as if we are only focusing on the content itself. But the social processes that are taking place, the society, the way society is accepting the ideas or not accepting the ideas, the kind of problems these scientists had to face in their time when they gave these revolutionary ideas. I think all those things are also very important in developing attitudes towards science. What do you think, Poonam? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely, Ruchi. Later on, so I think in the last session, when I gave the example of Newton, so, you know, what happens very often in the textbook, it will be given Isaac Newton, 1642 to 17 something something, 27. But what do those dates mean? When you say early 17th century or mid 17th century, what was the environment that time? It was not that only Newton was working on some understanding natural phenomena. There were so many other scientists, and as some of our esteemed colleagues have already mentioned, the need to actually understand not just the name of Newton, but also have the other names, and also understand the spirit of inquiry that was existing at that time. And there is, so that is the context. And then there is a meta context also, that in that era, it was not just science, but every other discipline that was, there was progress in all of them. So there was in the area of, so Newton wasn't just a scientist, he was actually a mathematician. So when you start going into that, you realize that, you know, all these things at the back end are, that's a modern word, but at the back end, interconnected and not compartmentalized as we encounter them today. So there was a spirit of inquiry. There was a need to express oneself. Scientists wanted to question everything and not take everything as was handed down to them from many centuries. They wanted to create their own knowledge. So that in itself is a very powerful idea. And students need to understand that it was not limited to the 17th century or the 18th or the 19th. That is an ongoing thing. Everyone who can think for themselves has the ability and should have the ability to observe something, question it, and do some work to get their own answers to those questions. And that is the whole purpose of teaching nature of science. So what I have done is, as I shared some stories with you last time, and I, like I said, I'm still understanding this whole process and I'm doing my research work on it. I put together a short process. Okay, so I'm going to share that with you, just a few steps in a more structured manner. And what I will do is I'll display this to you, and perhaps you can see how they can be useful to you, and we can talk around those steps. Yeah. So, So this is what this is how I had approached the, when I wanted to write these stories. This is what I did. So first of all, it began, like I said, with an intention that, and or understanding for me that nature of science is important, and it needs to be brought in into the classroom. Now, how can we actually, integrate it with our with a particular chapter? So, like Ruchi mentioned earlier, there are these. Every chapter has scientific has learning objectives. So I also wrote that in a particular chapter, what would I like to teach if I were a teacher? So I framed two separate sets of objectives, like concept objectives, which we anyway do as teachers. I also separately did nature of science objectives. Okay, so I'm just going to show you what it means. I'm going to increase the size of it because, yeah. So you can see that there are two distinct sets of objectives. One is focusing on recall the, how blood circulates in human body, the basic understanding. And importantly, I asked myself, what do I want students to know about nature of science in 8th standard? So I thought that they should at least say in their own words that what is the basic paradigm shift that William Harvey's work brought about. Then they should be able to recall the names of at least three other scientists who influenced Harvey's work. Now, this is in line with the concept that of NOS, which says that, scientists collaborate. And these discoveries are not the result of individual effort, isolated effort. And also to appreciate the rigor of experimentation that William Harvey brought in order to come to arrive at his conclusion. So I wrote these, I formulated separate objectives. Then when you look at your chapter, when you look at your list, the textbook chapter, you look for opportunities. I'm going to talk a little bit about opportunities later. And then you begin the search for stories, which also I will talk about briefly. Then you actually, once you do your research, you write down the story on one word document. And, maybe if you can find some images or which are authentic from authentic sources. And then you also embed questions in the story and say, that while I'm narrating the story in the class, what kind of questions I should be asking students? Because you don't want them to just passively listen. You also want them to think about certain things. And then, of course, what is very important, because we don't want, misconceptions to take place, etc. We also do a peer review. We can exchange these notes with other experts or other teachers with these stories. And we can say if there are no, factual errors or errors in interpretation of something, and then we can actually take it to the class and then you narrate it. That's the third step. So you time yourself how much time you're taking, because we have to be sensitive to the requirements of the syllabus. You can also make a note of students' reactions, what kind of questions they are asking. So the next time you can, when you narrate that same story, you can incorporate those things, that ideas and reactions, etc. Now, most important thing when you are narrating, you have to also make explicit connections with NOS. So just having them memorize three names of other scientists who work on, who worked with William Harvey or before, is not enough. You have to say that, look, this has been possible because of the collaboration of other scientists. Or you say that how scientific knowledge is tentative. So those deliberate connections have to be made by the teachers, by us, for our students. So this is a kind of a broad approach framework that I've come up. This is work in progress. So I would like to have your views and your reactions on and questions around this.
Any questions, please? Any clarification you want about the process? Anything that you feel should be added or can be done differently?
Chat, just see.
I have a question, Roshna here.
Yes, Roshna.
You mentioned about the objectives of content objectives and the NOS objectives.
Yes.
So when we go through each thing, does it always have to be something the students have to remember, or can it be something like taking them through the inquiry process, or maybe doing a small experiment which is related to that?
Absolutely.
I'm asking this question in context of the current scenario where we are not able to do any experiments. We are we don't have access to laboratories.
Yes.
So how can this connect to the problems we face due to the online education?
No, you're absolutely right, Roshna. We are at this stage. Because of the current situation we are in, the objectives need to be framed in according to your own objectives that you have in mind. This what I showed you was just an example of how I would have treated them. This story was, of course, I'm working on it before the pandemic happened, but that was just to show you that. That when you want to bring a story to the classroom, it always helps to have a separate objective to say that what is it about nature of science that I want to communicate to the story. That was the only purpose of showing you that example. Otherwise, the story itself can kind of distract from the conceptual knowledge, and it can sometimes become it can go all over the place. So you don't want that, right? So that's the only reason you write these objectives.
And just wanted to add about the pandemic context just give me a minute. Yeah. So about the pandemic context, I know that it might be difficult to do experiments right now, but stories is something that you can still do. Because if it involves students reading up about scientists and somebody narrating a story or talking about the story itself, I think that's an important idea. And as I think Aruna Prabhu initially was talking about thought experiment, I think that's an important idea that we can perhaps use in this point of time.
Yeah.
And perhaps even if you feel that you can devise an experiment which students can do in their homes with the whatever the materials are available. I think that would be something really interesting for you to go forward with it. But it is also important to think that after the experiment, what do students need to think about? How does one arrive at the conclusion? How does one even arrive at the experiment itself? Because these, when we look at these stories, they tell us about how a person thought differently and therefore created the experiment itself differently from what was done earlier. So these are the important points perhaps you can take up for your own classroom teaching. Poonam?
Yes, thanks, Ruchi, for adding for that added explanation. I teach. I just want to share something from my experience briefly here. I teach sixth and seventh standard science. There is an NGO near in my locality. I teach science there, and we've been having online classes for the last 1 year now. I gave them an exercise to do where. They had to, each one of them had to measure the time it takes for their mothers to make tea in the morning. And they had to write down on a piece of paper and share it with me on WhatsApp on how many cups of tea were made and how much time it took to boil the water. So we made correlation of cup and at the end of the, so, and what is the method used for making that tea? Some people mix tea and, sorry, water and milk. Some people put milk in the end and so on and so forth. Now, I told them to do this for a period of 6 to 7 days. And I was able to show to them that even in their own house, where the same person is making the tea and everything is more or less the same, the data changed considerably from day to day. Some days it would take 7 minutes for the water to boil, somewhere it would take 8 minutes, somewhere they would forget to switch on the timer and so on and so forth. It gives them a sense, this is very young children, and of course we had made sure that they are doing it in the presence of an adult, means they are not actually making the tea themselves, they are only observing. So we were able to, through that one small activity, we were able to say that what are the objects used to measure time, how they are writing it down, what are the mistakes that can come in writing things down, and so many things emerged from the simple activity, and we were able to connect it to nature of science to say that, see, scientists also do this, and even though they are grown-ups and they have laboratory equipment, they have they also make mistakes. And most importantly, scientists who were in the early age had fewer instruments and to measure certain things, and scientists in the newer age had more sophisticated instruments. And then finally, we were able to talk about direct ways of measuring and indirect ways of measuring certain things, things which are observable versus things that are not observable. So a simple experiment opened up this whole idea of nature of science and what it means in the larger world, scientific world. So I'm going to now just talk a little bit if there are no, somebody people.
Yeah, Dr. Ugin was saying that we can use simulations from Amrita Online Lab or even FET activities, and even when we are doing at home the experiments, we need to have safety precautions.
Yes,
I agree. That is a must, and that is diligent, supposed to be diligently followed.
Absolutely.
Go ahead.
So, like I said, that when you look at a chapter yourself, when you open a chapter, there are many opportunities which you can take to convert them into a story. For example, there are direct opportunities which are there in the form of these blurbs. So there will be a mention of Archimedes, Sorensen in the chapter of acid and base, and so many such things will be there, Goodyear and all that. Those become starting points or entry points for you to do some research on that and then tell a story around that. Sometimes there are indirect methods such as, you know, discovery of microscope. We never talk about it, but like I said, in the context of the tea experiment, the technology available to do scientific, to carry out scientific experiments is as important, and how the microscope has become more and more advanced, and that also is an opportunity. When I was doing my work, I found the mention of National Institute of Virology, which was opened in the 1950s in Pune. So that gave me an idea that, you know, why was virology, why was that institute opened? And I found that it was linked to the Spanish flu, which happened in 1918. And I immediately felt that if we talk about a story related to Spanish flu now, in this time, it would be so much, it would be very topical. And students would be very interested to know that same thing had happened 100 years ago. Another opportunity that comes is when you see something is missing. Okay, I'm referring to the 8th standard science textbook. And to the best of my knowledge, what I found is that there is absolutely no mention of any women scientists. So sometimes an opportunity presents itself for a story by not looking at what is there, but what is not there. Okay. So the first chapter itself, which is about plant classification, you see that so many scientists are mentioned. But if you just look at, just this is what I did. I just Googled plant classification, women scientists. And I found that there are so many women scientists who have done work, and the most, one of the most significant names that popped up was that of Beatrix Potter. Beatrix Potter was an illustrator and a storyteller. And though she never really went through the scientific route of being a PhD and all that, she is considered a scientist because she used to draw the plants that she used to observe. And she, her work is actually has gone into helping the classification of plants. So this is the way you kind of get the opportunity to create a story. Now this opportunity has to be converted into an authentic scientific story. And I'm just going to show you an example of taking it from credible sources. For me, for my research, some sources that I feel are credible are the Smithsonian, and for, very important for Indian scientists, it's the Indian Institute of Science. They have a very good compilation, and it would be very credible also because it is from Indian Institute of Science. All the women scientists and all the Indian scientists also, and what are their achievements. Sometimes I refer to Wikipedia also, but I want to say out loud that Wikipedia is only the starting point. Okay, let me show you how. Now, see, this is a story of, this is a Wikipedia entry of Janki Amal, who gave us did notable work on in agriculture, and she was a cytogeneticist. So can you see this? One is you have to be careful of copyright. So can you see this? A Creative Commons by attribution license has to be there. We cannot use material otherwise. And from the Wikipedia page, you can go to the references section, in which the you can see the highlighted areas are the more authentic documents from where information about a scientist's life and their achievements can be had. So this is the one way in which you can approach creation of these stories for nature of science. We have already seen this, so I'm not going into that. So, yeah. So any questions so far? I mean, any thoughts on what I have just shared? Any reflection?
Ma'am, you said that sometimes the story can be distracting. Can you give an example when a story would be a distracting situation?
So what I had said is that if we don't construct the story around a specific nature of science objectives, in such cases, the story can become become very lengthy and reach no particular objective. That is what I meant. I really don't have an example right off the bat, but
yeah, so even if you take the Archimedes story, if the student just fixate on a certain aspect which does not really help them in understanding about science itself,
yeah.
Many people, even after having read Archimedes' story, do not really understand the concept of density or how it relates to the concept of density itself.
Yeah.
So, therefore, that is not to say that we should not use that story. That is to say that even after reading the story, there is a certain kind of processing. There is a certain kind of question and discussion that needs to be had with the student itself, because the science, doing science, thinking science is about being able to make conclusions.
Absolutely.
From what you have observed. And that is something that, you need to help students to think about. Otherwise, students will just think, okay, the water just that comes out, that indicates density. But they do not really understand how it indicates density.
Yeah.
Right? Right, Poonam?
Absolutely. That's a,
thank you. Thank you so much.
So, see, if we open up the idea of history of certain of science, there will be so many such, everything has a history, right? This pencil that I have here also has a history. So does that mean that each and everything that has a history becomes a candidate for, you know, narrating in the class? And how do you decide? And who decides that what happens? What should be talked about? So one criteria that, of course, because I am not currently working as a teacher, one thing that I have focused on is to see what is there in the textbook. But over and above that, what research says is that focus on important ideas that have a long conceptual shelf life. Now, atomic theory, for example, or density, or electricity, or circulation, body, human processes, these have a long conceptual shelf life. By that I mean that they are going to be coming in different levels of complexity from starting from 6th and 7th standard all the way up to high school and beyond if the student decides to pursue science. So it would help to focus on those concepts that are the foundation or the building blocks of more advanced concepts that are being taught later. Another research-based guideline that I learned about is that you have to link stories to the present, because it should not seem, nature of science should not seem like something that is existing in the bygone era, that this is, you know, first it was like that, now it is different. No, we have to show that it has been changing, but it is all sort of connected, and it should also connect to other science content in the textbook. Okay. That is also something that is considered important when you're teaching science, nature of science through stories. If you would recall, in my last session, I had talked about, how William Harvey saw this whole blood circulation system as a circle, or about how Lise Meitner, she visualized this, the atom of uranium as a water drop. Of course, that was not her own idea. It was another scientist had proposed the water drop model. But when you use the words that they have thought in their autobiographies or something, it really helps to the students tend to kind of, it lends to authenticity, and it helps students get into the shoes of the scientist as much as it is possible. Just those words, a few catchphrases here and there are considered. The research has found that it has a far more impact on the student understanding nature of science than just not including it. And as I said earlier, there is you have to include those parts of the story which match your NOS objectives, because otherwise, again, that same point that I was making, the story can become very big and it can lead to nowhere. There are some things that, I would just like to kind of complete this part before I bring it back to you. There are some things which you have to avoid while writing these stories and narrating them. So the first one is called, portraying scientists as these brilliant, brave people who, and in the process, actually end up covering their flaws and their errors and the contribution of other scientists. I think we talked about it in the last session also. We cannot have them valorize them to such an extent where we hide their flaws is also. And in the same breath, I would say that portraying the research designs as flawless, or showing that this experiment led to this finding, so drawing a very linear connection between the experimentation and the finding, which is called in science as naive empiricism, is actually you should avoid that. There is a tendency for scientists actually to dramatize their own discoveries, such as Newton, okay? He said that, oh, and I was sitting and an apple fell on my head and it dawned on me that there is a force acting upon this thing. Similarly, I don't know if you've heard of Kekule's dream, who was struggling.
Yes, I have.
Yes, it's a very, again, a popular
thing. I have never forgotten that story from the time my professor had shared in the college. And I was just thinking about it.
Yes.
Kekule's dream.
The thing is that he never actually had that dream. Now, what is it saying? But he in various forums, when they present their papers, they add different ways of grabbing their audiences also. So see the effect of story. It's not that we as educators also, we are trying to use it, but scientists themselves narrativize their experience to attract and to explain complex things. So when he talked about a snake biting its own tail, it is his way. And then he had to, you know, put a context to it. So he said, oh, I got a dream. And again, that has become as popular as Eureka or Apple. So that was his way of conveying. So we should avoid that by showing that Kekule got a dream. Otherwise, it sends a wrong message again, like Newton's apple, because they will say that, oh, Kekule got a dream, but what about me? How will I make a discovery? So that kind of representation should really be avoided. And finally, the whole thing of justification of an experiment that, you know, especially Rutherford, we just show that this experiment led to this result. And we say that the experiment was, you know, correct experiment leads to correct result and wrong experiments lead to wrong result. This kind of a justificatory method of showing is actually leads to a lot of misconceptions. In the last story, I told you that William Harvey did dissection on 40 species to arrive at a certain idea of circulation. Similarly, there is a story of digestion where there was the person in whose name is coming in the textbook, Dr. William Beaumont. He made several, 250 or something kind of times he experimented on, he conducted in order to arrive at certain findings. So that is, and some of them would have been wrong. Okay, or had errors, not wrong, would have had errors. So that is an important thing. There's some activity on the chat, so I'm just going to take a look. And that's pretty much what I had to say. We can conclude now. And as I said, that there is a meta context also. And we already discussed this particular point. So I would now like to kind of conclude this presentation. And if you have any questions or any more ideas based on whatever I have shown, I know it's less time, but we can actually conclude this session, but I would still like to hear from you all.
Thank you, Poonam. Thank you for having this second session with us and making us think a little bit more about this idea of stories and how to use that in the classroom. I'm just going to share the feedback form with all of you. And meanwhile, if you have any questions for Poonam, please feel free to ask. And also, if you have joined the Telegram group and if you ever try it out with any of your students, do share your experience in the Telegram group. See, we would really like to hear that. And we should be able to use this Telegram group to continue the connection that we have made in this online mode. Otherwise, this will just remain a few lectures that you perhaps listen and then forget, and you do not ever try it out in your classroom.
Yeah, and I would be happy to provide support. And like the other experimenters, there will be some errors. When you try something like this, there will be some, but that's the whole idea of doing an experiment. So I would really urge you to, you know, include more stories and tell them and see what happens. And we are kind of, we have this community, which we are through of the Telegram, through which we can ideate and resolve those problems, if any. So once again, from my on my behalf, thank you so much for your kind attention and for your participation. And I look forward to being continuously in touch with some of you and working on this.
Okay, so I have shared the feedback form link. You can fill it up. Thanks a lot, Poonam. Thanks for a wonderful session that we had. And we will definitely continue interacting with the teachers. There have been a few requests of email ID of Poonam. I'm not sure if Poonam is comfortable giving out an email ID in a public forum right now. But that is the reason why we have made this Telegram group, so that we can provide some safe avenue for people to just share their ideas and take the discussion forward. Poonam, it's we can discuss it later about whether we want to give out email ID or not. So right now I will not insist on doing that. I understand there might be implications for that. See, it's not safe to give out one's email ID in a public forum, and therefore I am not giving it out. So please do share your ideas on School Synergy Telegram group if you are there. We will definitely share it with Poonam, and we can have discussions there itself. Yeah. So I have shared the feedback form. You can fill it up and submit it. If you have any issues, I'm here. You can tell me. I'm hanging on for just 5 more minutes. Poonam, if you want to leave, you can leave. And I just want to once more thank you. Thanks a lot. And thank all of you for being such a wonderful audience and interacting with us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. So yes, we have recorded it, and I will share it on the Synergy. School Synergy Teachers Forum. What are you just wanted to know everyone's views who are there. Is it okay to release on YouTube if there is any issue in releasing on YouTube for any of the persons who share their idea today in the session? Please let me know right now in the chat that you're not okay for the sessions to be released on YouTube. It's better to know it right now. Okay, thank you. If anybody has any problem in getting, if this session is released on YouTube, please let us know right now. Thank you. Please fill the feedback form and let us know if you're able to submit it. So I'll just put my video off, and I'm here if anybody has any issues. I'll stop the recording.